Right? This is not going to be popular with a lot of the young sisters out there, but I'm going to give you some auntie learning here. Okay?
Go for it.
It's really nice being looked after by a man. I said
MashaAllah.
it. Oh my God, I said it. Ah, it's gonna rain. It's gonna rain molten lead on my head.
Okay, Bismillah, Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala Rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in amma ba'd. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah everyone. Today I have a special guest and she's coming to us all the way from Istanbul, Turkey, and her name is Sister Lauren Booth. Assalamu alaikum, sister, how are you?
Wa alaikum salam rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah, I greet you from a very wet, 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 wet and rainy Istanbul, but mashallah, great time to make dua.
Alhamdulillah. And I'm in Chicago. If I go outside, there's snow all over the place. Perhaps you may be missing the snow. I'm not sure.
Yeah, I miss snow. I'm a snow person. I love it. Do you like snow?
Not as much, but my kids, they do. They want to go snow sledding and they enjoy, they play around. Alhamdulillah, right? Children, mashallah. So in your video, you mentioned that you call yourself as a revert and not necessarily as a convert. So the viewers who may not know the difference, especially our non-Muslim brothers and sisters, why would you call yourself as a revert, Sister Lauren?
So, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, in the name of Allah, the most beneficent, the most merciful. For me, as somebody who grew up in a Christian context in the United Kingdom, the history of the word conversion seems to be tainted with either a kind of enforcement ideal or a colonial ideal, we can say. So, you know, if you're converted, it means everybody thinks that there's some kind of pressure on you from another human being. The idea of a reversion to something is how I felt. I felt that once I left my old way of life and started to pray and really cleanse myself of a lot of bad habits and attitudes, not all, we're all a work in progress. This is not, you know, there's nothing, you know, great or finished about the person before you, astaghfirullah azeem. But to begin to begin that work felt like I was coming back to a kind of pre-teen, not purity, but innocence. Yes.
MashaAllah. Also from the Islamic point of view, as you may be aware, many a times we also say a person has reverted to Islam because we feel and we say, and Islam says this, that every child is born on the natural fitra, on the natural inclination to be a Muslim. They have that, spiritual chip, as we say, right? So for that person, for that reason, a person is now coming back to the original innate state. So they are reverting back to that original state, right? So that's also one of the reasons people use the word revert. Is it true that in the UK, about 5,000 people of their own choice, they are converting or reverting to Islam? In the USA, the statistics are about 20,000 each year of their own choice.
Would I'm just going to say that actually 5,000 sounds too little. In the
Oh,
UK.
Really? I see. Okay.
You know, just meeting people day in, day out, and a lot of people convert in secret. I've met some elderly. I remember going to I think it was a poetry reading years ago, about 8 years ago now. And there was this very dear old lady. She reminded me of my granny. You know, she had white hair and little glasses. And she said, Salaam alaikum. I was like,
MashaAllah.
I'm Muslim. She said, yes, but my family don't know and nobody knows. It's just, and then another gentleman, similarly, he said, yes, my family don't know. So you'd be amazed. I was actually, I've been shopping in central London and a right, you know, rough looking, quite a street looking girl with her hair out and I said, Assalamu alaikum. I said, you Muslim? She said, yeah, because you got converted. And it's like, God, Allah be with you. You'd be amazed. Allahu Akbar. Particularly
Allahu
women.
Yeah. I mean, even in USA, 60% women to 40% men conversion ratio.
So I heard 75% to 25% in Europe.
Really? Wow. Is that high? MashaAllah. So the reason I brought that, you know, the perceptions, because in USA, there are a lot of Latinos, Hispanic background people, they are converting or reverting to Islam. So now people, when they look them in the media, the stories are covered, you know, in CNN and in Chicago Tribune, New York Times, that Latinos are coming to Islam. Now people may be thinking, you know what, we used to think that Islam is a faith of the Arabs, Indian Pakistanis, but here our own people, they are converting or reverting to Islam. So they may be thinking, you know what, perhaps Islam is not just a faith of based upon certain culture, certain race. So they now may be thinking that, yes, let us also look into it. Let's also read the Quran. No, as a sister, mashallah, you know, coming to Islam, there are so many misconceptions people have, especially about women in Islam. There was a survey that came out maybe 3-4 years ago in the USA Today newspaper. And they mentioned a list of the misconceptions people have. The number one misconceptions is about women in Islam. Right. Women wearing the hijab, it's a sign of oppression. They're second class. They are not equal to men. All of these misconceptions is number one in the USA. So what would you say to a non-Muslim brother or a sister that despite all of these misconceptions, you chose Islam? Why?
SubhanAllah.
How does Islam treat a women?
I think what I noticed when I visited Palestine and Lebanon was that there was a dignity, self-control, and a respect afforded to the women in hijab, in habaya, in jilbab, that I hadn't felt or connected to for years as a successful Western journalist. Now, it's a very long discussion to talk about why that's going on, but we can definitely look towards the sexualization of young women, the expectations to have multiple partners, the lack of the way that esteem is so interlinked with our sensuality in the workplace. I know I got some jobs because the editor fancied me. I knew the game. Come on. I mean, come on, sisters. Let's be honest here. You know, if you're plainer, you have to work harder than the one with the nicest hair. That's what hair products sell, right? It's not because we really want to flick our hair. We don't spend our time, well, actually now, actually in front of the phone, it's a bit different. You do spend a lot of time flicking your hair for yourself. I take that back. But it all diminishes, all of that behavior diminishes the essence of us. The essence of us, number one, is a spiritual being trying to understand and process what being alive means, and what it's for, and who do we serve, and how do we serve, and who is God. And so I was starting to feel really diminished. I diminished myself. I cheapened myself in a lot of ways. And I don't think women in their 20s would use the language I use, but actually we'd express a similar feeling about there's got to be more to life than this, and more to me than an hour and a half a day doing my it's all about the eyelashes, and it's all about the hair. Is it really? Isn't it about what we're presenting, what we're talking about, and the good we're doing? You know. So when I wear this, I mean, I was somebody who could be described as a head turner in their 20s and 30s. Men would turn and look at me in the street. Nobody looks at me with this on. Oh. And that's a blessing. And it's a big challenge to the nafs, to the ego.
As we always say that Islam respects a person's personality, spirituality, religiosity, and not for, you know, the shape of the body or the makeup and all of that. So Islam has higher values, the respect that we provide to our mothers, our sisters, our wives, our daughters. So it's just paradoxical that the more misconceptions people have about women, the more women are entering Islam.
We're tired. We're tired of this idea of anything goes freedom. It's exhausting when there are no ethics and no rules and you can do what you like all the time. You will always go down a rabbit hole of identity crisis, self-obsession, and addiction. 99% of the time. You're going to start off here and you're going to go down there. And it's either going to take 1 year or it can take 30 years. But there are far too many. I come from a family, sadly, blighted by generations of alcoholics both my parents were alcoholics. Ex-husband had an alcohol issue. I had an alcohol issue. What is this society doing to us? This is to discover a clean way of life and to stick to it, not just for health reasons, but because it's told by God, who wants to nurture us. And I think that's really pivotal here, because one of the things I hear quite often from non-Muslims and Christians is a very valid point. You gave up drinking, drugs, and smoking. You could have done that without Islam. You're right. Islam, we fast in Islam, but we don't fast to lose weight or because we're on the 5-2 diet. Mm-hmm. These things are done to please the one who created us. And the return that we get is out of this world. Allahu Akbar. Blessings and miracles every single day. It's like being carried on with by an invisible hand. That's the only way I can describe it.
You know, as a sister, I mean, for me, I can speak so much about the rights, the freedoms that Islam gives to women. Perhaps can you highlight just a few of them quickly, so our viewers, especially our non-Muslim sisters, they can know that, yes, you know, wonderful ways that Islam has honored and lifted women.
Subhanallah. Well, the first thing that you won't know if you're not Muslim is that men and women are equal before Allah Ta'ala, except in the only individual differences are to do with piety. So there may be the one who prays more in the night, the one who gives more sadaqah. It's all about giving of yourself and changing the self. Islam isn't about, being ourselves. It's about learning to improve ourselves. So it's the improved human being standing side by side. And that's really a wonderful feeling to stand with people, you know, before the Kaaba and know that the Lord is greater than all of us. So that's kind of I think that in itself is a really, really big relief. Now, this is going to be unpopular. Okay. Mm-hmm. This is not going to be popular with a lot of the young sisters out there. But I'm going to give you some auntie learning here, okay?
Go for it.
It's really nice being looked after by a man.
Mashallah.
I said it. Oh my God, I said it. Ah, it's going to rain. It's going to rain molten lead on my head. I am 53 years old. I worked for myself pretty much since I was 16 years old, okay? I am tired. When I was pregnant, I was working. When I was breastfeeding, I was working. I was always the one who had to make the most money. I was always the one who paid my own bills. Isn't it tiring? Isn't it really hard paying your own way all the time? You know, and let's be honest, you're still going to do the washing up at the end of the night and change the nappies because the kids need you in that way. And because, you know, that... Yeah, okay, we're not allowed to say that genders are different, but let's be honest, the fitra of the man and the woman is different. Told you this is going to be unpopular, but this is the reality that I've lived. Your reality may be different, but I tend to think that God knows how he made us, you know, subhanAllah. Right. So what I'm saying is this, Islam tells the man that his responsibility is to carry the weight off the shoulders of his family, the worry of provision. And once you have the worry of provision off your shoulders, as much as the man can, I'm not talking Porsches and Lamborghinis here. I'm talking about your daily stuff is taken care of. You know what? You really get to be you. You really get to be kind. You really get to spend time with what matters and to give care in return. I haven't stopped working because my husband takes care of me. I'm enabled to do as much as I can. Allahu Akbar.
MashaAllah, that is even though unpopular, but I believe there may be millions and billions of sisters out there, ladies, who would like to just stay home, take care of the kids, you know, maybe read, become scholars, find new talents, compared to having full-time job, full-time responsibility at home, stress comes in, lack of sleep, and person become, you know, irritable with the husband, with the children.
Alhamdulillah, but I'm going to be straightforward here because we should be people of truth. There are sisters who are run into the ground by husbands who exhaust them. And I've seen that in the Muslim community. They may not have to work a full-time job, but they don't even get a thank you. Now, that's not Islam. That's that's a man who doesn't realize the beauty of his responsibility and what kindness does. So human beings are human beings, but when the balance is right, I've seen people really thrive here in a way that is special.
Obviously, the viewers, they would like to know, Lauren, you were following some other ideology, some other faith, and now you have, by your own choice, you have embraced Islam. So briefly, if you can highlight, you know, what sparked you to look into Islam and then finally made the decision saying La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah.
I wasn't looking to change my faith. When my daughters were born, I went back to my Christian faith. I always believed in one God. I believed that Jesus at the time was the Son of God, although I found that confusing. I didn't like to go too much into the whole Son of God thing. But I knew that Jesus had been an amazing man. But the three in one, the Trinity, never really made sense. But I wanted my daughters to have some grasp of that we're not just in this material world to gain stuff. I mean, you know, I was very wealthy when they were born by the grace of Allah. We had a very good lifestyle, and I could see them at 3 years old asking for, mummy, can we have rock for our choice of cheese after? And I'm like, oh, who are these human beings? What are we making? So we really went to church quite a good deal, mashallah. But so I wasn't unhappy. But when I went to Palestine in 2005 and 2006, and I met Muslims and stayed in their houses and was treated so kindly by people who had, quite frankly, really terrible living conditions, but were so content and so generous, I thought, these are either people from, I thought they were aliens. To be honest, brother, I thought that the Palestinians had come from a different planet, maybe in a spaceship, and landed there.
Why would you say that?
Because they didn't seem like the human beings I'd met before in my life.
I see. Because they are Muslims, Muslim clothing.
Nothing to do with the clothing. Just, you know, for example, if you'd go into a little apartment in Ramallah or Jenin, and you'd see, say, that picture behind me, and you say, oh, that's nice. They take it and go, here you go.
Oh, really? Mashallah.
Yeah. There's no question. You say you like something, they're done with it. It's done.
Is there etiquette? And, you know, not the dressing, yeah. It's the way that they behave with you.
The etiquette. I mean, they love these people that I met for the first time. They knew I was Christian. You know, I could have been a spy. The whole of West Bank and Gaza is full of spies doing damage to them, but it never crossed their mind. They just gave you the best food and gave you the best bed and looked after you more than people who had said they loved me had looked after me or I had loved. And whenever I said, why come you guys are like this? They'd always go, you see, that's that book up there. And I said, what book? The Quran. And so I came to believe that the Quran was a guidebook of manners. I didn't really think of it as scripture from God, but I did think about it as a guidebook to daily life of manners. And I recognized that my manners, my kindness wasn't up to scratch. And so I remember in Jerusalem one day, I was leaving from a trip to Palestine. I went as a journalist. I asked a young man, a young Shabab Palestinian lad, if he could find me a Quran in English. And he went running around and he bought it to me. And I had lots of other bags of souvenirs that I was supposed to pay him for. I said, how much do I owe you? And he said, oh, you don't owe us anything. Just one thing. He said, please remember Palestine when you go. SubhanAllah. And that's how I got my first ever copy of the Quran. Excuse me, forgive me.
Go ahead, Linda.
Yeah, so that's alhamdulillah.
It was in what year was that?
2007.
Okay, mashallah, about 13 years ago. So then you read the Quran, then you said, La ilaha illallah.
No. I read Al-Fatiha and I said, oh, okay, it sounds like the Lord's Prayer from Christianity. And I read a bit of Baqarah and I got to the verse in Baqarah where Allah Ta'ala talks about the person who in public says that they are a believer, but they're lying. And when they're with their demons, when they're with their shaitan, when they're with their inner voice, the ugly voice, not the good voice, the ugly voice, that they're laughing, going, I'm not really like that. And I thought, oh my God, this book knows about my heart. That is so weird that I was scared. The book just scared me. And I thought, wow, nice people. Because then it goes on to say, you're going to hell, they're the liars. And I'm like, okay, so that's me then. That's me going to hell. So I thought, lovely people, scary book. And the next time I read the Quran, subhanAllah, was after I converted. So I took a big risk.
So you got scared by reading some of the passages, I guess, right?
Yeah. Yeah. The Quran tells you what you need to hear, subhanAllah. Often, when we come from, actually anybody approaching the Quran for the first time, it's not a linear book. It's not like a beginning, middle and end story book. It is, you know, you can pick it up and you can take four lines and you can say, whoa, that's my message for today. And you can open another page and there'll be another four lines. You go, oh, I needed to hear that. Let me see if I can implement that. So the structure allows it to speak to you in a very kind of rapid fire sort of way. SubhanAllah.
Correct, correct. Because Allah's book is the most beautiful, the best of all guidance. It has balance between the incentive to Allah has given to go to paradise and obviously some shake up to the people just to warn them that if they don't straighten up, this may happen to them. So alhamdulillah, it's the best book, the balanced book. So it's how a person approaches it. If the person is coming from certain background, they may find certain verses and they may think, you know what? Yes, that's me. Let me just, you know, come back to the creator. You know, that we all need that wake up call. And then you had that wake up call when you read Surah Fatiha and certain passages from Surah Baqarah, because without the wake up call, we cannot make a U-turn. We cannot choose something better, which may be out there. So we all need that, Sister Lauren.
Mm-hmm. It's true, you know. And the interesting thing about that wake up call was this. Number one, it reaffirmed to me that I believed in God. Mm-hmm. Because it really scared me. I heard the voice of God in that book. I'd read the King James Bible, you know, many times. And then I'd come to the Quran and it's like same voice, only more direct. Very, very direct, speaking directly to you. You've got to do this. I can see you. I know what your heart is doing. Change up. These are the two options. And this option is open, but you have to change now. And so I think that's a really important part of it. And some people at that point may put it down, but if you come back to it with an open heart, it's really about the approach. So I get a couple more visits to Palestine. I came in 2008. I think I was very close to accepting in 2008, but I still wasn't ready. And then in 2010, Ramadan, I was in a mosque. And I had the most amazing feeling, just like all of my worries went. Just, I was sitting on a mat on the floor, surrounded by people of another culture and feeling just sheer, unadulterated peace and joy. And I knew it was true. And a week later, I took my shahada, subhanAllah.
Allahu Akbar, la ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. Did you have any Muslim friends? Maybe they were telling you something beautiful about the Quran, about Islam. You know, there are Muslims in the UK, right? MashaAllah, there are millions up there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'd started working with Muslims. And here was the funny thing. Various TV, Islam channel, I'd done some work with them. And every time I came home, I'd say to my daughters, oh my God, Muslims are such nice people. You'll never guess what happened today. And it came to the point where they'd actually mimic me. I'd say, girls, and they'd come in and go, you'll never guess what the Muslims did today. And the Muslims are such nice people. It's like, all right. I know I say that a lot. But it was incredible. Suddenly I realized that these aliens in Palestine who were super nice human beings, it wasn't because of their tribal difference. It wasn't that the Palestinians are like, oh, the Muslims. It's Islam. It's faith that has made them transcend so much of a human emotional detritus, because I saw it the same in London. I saw it the same in Leeds with families. I started to meet in Lebanon, subhanAllah.
Sister Lauren, obviously your parents at that time, I'm not sure what is their status now, they were from the Christian background, right? Mm-hmm. What was their reaction? Did you just knocked at the door, came home to your parents and said, you know, mom, dad, I'm a Muslim now. Mm-hmm. What did you do? I mean, what was the reaction?
It's, you know, it's very cute when people from a Muslim cultural background talk about family life. You know, when you're speaking to converts, the whole you knock on the door and mum and dad thing is there is probably a little bit, yeah, we don't often have that scenario. What we have is massively broken families and addiction and other real life stuff going on. So my parents weren't married at the you know, at the time. So my dad, who I wasn't seeing a lot at the time, was just worried about feminism, really. Was mm-hmm. I going to be locked up in a dungeon and, you know, by some bearded man who was going to be awful to me? He's like, just don't let them do that to you. And I'm like, Dad, you know me. I'm not gonna let that happen, God willing. You know, I'm still me. He's like, yeah, but don't let it happen. I'm like, Dad. So he couldn't really see over that at the time. And my mum would have described herself as an Islamophobe. She's like, oh, you've joined the nutters, have you? The nutty brigade, the terrorists. All right, then go on then. But she loved me. And God bless her. She never made, you know, one time, only once did she start mocking Islam or the Quran in front of me. And I was in her house and I remembered, you know, what Allah Ta'ala tells us, just go away and come back until they stop. So you don't say, I hate you, you're a kafir and I'm never seeing you again. And I didn't know. She said, da, 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 and the prophet and this. And I said, Mum, I can't be in the room while you're doing this. So I'm going to leave. And when you're done, give me a call. I'll be back. Okay, I love you. Oh, don't be like that. I gave it 5 minutes. She said, yeah, okay, come back in now. And she never did it again.
MashaAllah.
Never, MashaAllah.
So there may be many new Muslim sisters who may be also watching this, and maybe brothers too. They may not know how to properly deal with their families who are not yet Muslims. So what advice would you give them? Maybe the family members may have misconceptions, just like your parents did. What would you tell them, sister?
To be extremely gentle. That's you know, extremely gentle. People have had expectations of you. They might have liked you as you were. You may have been struggling inside, but they you know, my mum always said, where's my heavy drinking, smoking football fan? It's like, that's really who you want me to be? What? But that's who she got used to and who her daughter was. And then there's this, you know, she's calling me, oh, little Miss Piety. I mean, believe me, you'll get those things. But we have to come at this with love, subhanAllah, love and duty. Serve your parents, don't break family ties, and just be as kind as you can and show them that you're happy. Many, many families with a convert in them will have a brother or sister who convert, even a parent who converts. I remember a couple of years ago, I was standing on a chair and putting in a bulb for my mum, and I'm a bit shaky on chairs myself. And she said, you know what? When I look at you doing things like that for me, I say, thank you, God. Now, that literally in Arabic is alhamdulillah.
Yes.
Right? Best moment of my life. Allahu Akbar. My mum just said alhamdulillah because I was doing some small good thing for her. Now, it's a long journey. And if there's abuse, you know, take a little break, but don't break the ties. Don't break the ties, because you might have been put into that family for somebody else. In fact, you have been put into your family to bring them truth, guidance, and love.
You know, by becoming a better daughter, going out of the way, helping them out the way Islam is telling us, they may be thinking, you know what? This was how my son, my child, my daughter was before. And now look at them, the transformation that we see in their reflection. So that itself may make them ponder and think, who knows, they may be thinking it can be because of Islam. Right?
Yeah, inshallah. My mom died a month ago.
Okay, may Allah make it easy for you, sister. And but you did dawah to her, right? To your parents, to your dad, your mom.
I just gave them love. That's it. Just gave them love and let them see that.
Alhamdulillah. You know, I mean, that's all we can do, sister. May Allah accept your efforts. And we pray that if your dad is still alive, may Allah give him hidayah. And your family members, the rest of your extended family, your siblings, and you know, the rest of humanity. Sister, what tips that you can give to our Muslim brothers, our Muslim sisters, who may be thinking, you know what, these are the kuffar, these are the non-Muslims, let them be the way it is. What do you think our obligation as a Muslim to the greater society?
Do you know what? I was in a car with an elderly auntie. We were doing some gatherings for aunties and uncles who were on their own in Ramadan. Mm-hmm. And we were driving home to Manchester, through Manchester, and an auntie was in the back of my car. And we'd hit the perfect storm of really, really, youth events in the city centre. And it's 11:30 at night, and there's a festival and a football match. The most drunk and half-naked people you can see in Manchester in one time, all converged. And she said, oh, look at those dirty girls. And I started to cry. And I said, please, please don't speak about my people like that. And please don't speak about our young sisters in humanity like that.
Yeah.
We must never, ever, that's somebody's daughter. That girl that you're mocking.
Mm.
You know, that's somebody's child. And they need help and they don't know where to get it. And they don't know why they're alive. And the very least we can do is be merciful. Why do you think that Allah Ta'ala has put us in the West? Most of our brothers and sisters, you know, in Muslim lands, they come from places that were already Muslim. So why has Allah Ta'ala taken you from a Muslim place to a non-Muslim place? What is your duty? Your duty isn't to look down on people, astaghfirullah, because if you've got kibbeh in your heart, you're not going, you know, you're going to have a hard time on Yawmul Qiyam, all of us. You know, if we have riyah, if we have pride, you know, we've got to be so careful, subhanAllah. So I'll just give you an example. Don't be afraid to speak to people about spirituality, okay? And about us knowing Allah Ta'ala, about there being one God. They need it. And you know, I hear this a lot from brothers and sisters, and they say, I never like to speak to white people about God because, you know, they might get angry. If you know them, right, presumably you're not going to go up and say, hey, God, right? Otherwise, that's weird, and you will get a weird reaction. But if you've known someone 6 months, 2 months, or you're having a nice, even if you're having a nice extended conversation, are you okay? Do you pray? When I pray and I find this, you may find their heart is open at that moment because everybody needs help. Just to end on this story, I was on a plane coming from Qatar about 4 years ago, and the man in front of me getting onto the plane was a big, beery British guy with tattoos, and I thought, oh, don't let me sit next to him. Mm-hmm. And you know, he was in 43E, I was 43D, and I thought, subhanAllah, okay. So during the flight, he turned to me and he was drinking wine. He said, do you want my water? As if, oh, I couldn't, really? Speak English. Do you want my water? I said, yes. So then I had his water and I thought, oh, I better give him something back. I said, well, do you want my cheese? He said, thank you. Do you speak English? I'm like, listen, mate, I live in Manchester. He's like, so do I. And long story short, within 45 minutes, he was crying next to me saying he wanted to commit suicide. And he wasn't happy with his life and that he was doing awful things to people that he loved. And when he got off the plane, I gave him a Quran. And I spoke to him I asked Allah, I said, Allah, why are we having this conversation? It's not because he's speaking to Lauren. It's not because I'm in 43D. It's because he needs one thing. What's the one thing? You know this, brother, Tawheed.
Of course.
Nothing else. Nothing else in our conversation matters or will stay in his mind or heart, except There's only one God. So I said to him, when you get depressed, do you pray? He said, oh, I don't believe in any of that stuff. And then he said something so sweet. Remember, big, big guy. He said, when I'm really sad, sometimes I look at my mum's picture and I say, please, mum, help me.
Oh, really?
How sad is that? So I said to him, did your mum pray? He said, yeah, she used to pray to God. She was very pious. I said, just an idea. Next time you're sad, why don't you ask the one that your mum asked? And it was like a light went on. He went, oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. That's a brilliant idea. Alhamdulillah. So, you know, had I gone with preconceptions, had I maybe not been, you know, English myself, it would have been a bit harder. But don't think that people don't need God. Don't think for any moment that we're blessed and they're not. They just, like you did, they need the key.
Alhamdulillah. You know, when I look at what happened in the U.S. Capitol Hill, riots, people taking over, five people passed away. Yes, the whole world is angry. We are shocked. But again, then I have to look at myself. I have to think, you know what? Maybe Sabeel has not done my job to give them the proper guidance, the proper education, the proper connection with the Creator. So I think it's important that you're 100% right. I could have been in India, Hyderabad, but Allah sent me here with my parents to the USA for a purpose. I mean, I don't have any excuse to live in the USA if I'm not conveying the message of Islam to them. You know, so we can close off with this. There is a wonderful passage in the Quran, wonderful ayah in the Quran, Surah 16, ayah number 125. And you may have heard this before. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم ادعو إلى سبيل ربك بالحكمة وموعظة الحسنة وجادلهم بالتي هي أحسن. That invite all to the way of Allah with wisdom and good preaching and converse with them in ways which are best and most gracious. So this should be our guiding light that yes, we have to fulfill our personal obligations, our family obligations, but then we have a greater, higher obligation to humanity. These are our brothers and sisters. If we don't fulfill it, they will hold us accountable on the day of judgment that you Muslims had so many masajis. You had the knowledge, you had the blessings, you had the obligation, but you guys failed to convey to us the message. We were drowning in darkness. You forgot to pull us out from it. So all of these things should make Muslims, you, me, and all of us, to go out of the way, to reach out, to educate them, and to do dua for them, to supplicate for them. If they embrace the faith, fine, good for them. If they don't, at least for us, we have completed our obligation.
I mean, Ya Rabbal, I mean, that is a beautiful and very, very important ayah, mashallah, tabarakallah. Yeah, always with beautiful preaching and being of service. So be of service to your neighbors. We must be of service to those in need as much as we possibly can. The Muslims are inherently generous, not because we were just born generous. We learnt to be generous by the Holy Quran, the Book of Manners, subhanAllah. I'd love to invite some of the brothers and sisters to know more about what I'm doing, inshallah.
Yes, please go ahead. So how can someone look at your videos or get more information about your conversion story or about the activism that you're doing, dawah work that you're doing? Where can they find this?
So there are two main places for where you can find out about my work. Lauren Booth.co.uk. You can sign up to my courses there called Find Your Voice. I want to upskill the ummah to be leaders in the mainstream. And that means having the ability to speak in a confident manner, to present ourselves well, and to be authentically ourselves. We don't have to be derivative of anybody else. Okay, if you're Aisha, you don't have to be Holly. You know, you can be you. in the workplace, and you don't have to put up with bullying? How do you find and increase your confidence? So I'm really all about that. So you can go to Find Your Voice, click the link. It's on Teachable, which is a mainstream platform. And also you can find me on the Salam Initiative website on YouTube. And I do a program there called Tayyib Way. And Tayyib Way is about a variety of ethical implementations that you can put into daily life. So whether it's planting seeds in your back garden or growing herbs in a pot or learning about organic farming from an Islamic perspective, it's all there on that channel, Salam Initiative. And that's on YouTube. You can look up Tayyib Way, inshallah ta'ala.
MashaAllah, yes, we are going to display that inshallah, where they can find. And last but not the least, suppose if you have like a 30-second encounter, maybe in the grocery store, maybe elevator, maybe somewhere with a non-Muslim brother or sister, what would you tell them about Islam?
The first thing I'd hope in an elevator is that my phone doesn't go off with the adhan, because I've had that and it goes, Allahu Akbar, and you're like, nah, you know, because the other person looks so scared. So that's the first thing, is I hope that your adhan doesn't go off in the elevator, subhanAllah. In 30 seconds, I wouldn't speak about Islam. I would just be polite and see if they needed any help.
Or maybe a short time, you know, some other place, may not be elevator. What would you say about Islam, right?
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. I don't like the idea of doing things in a short time.
Or if someone asks you about Islam, tell us, you know, we have a short time. What would you say?
Yes, subhanAllah. If I have a short time with somebody and they say, why are you Muslim?
Mm-hmm.
I say, because God is one and he wants to help you and he wants to help me get through this test and to reward us and give us love. And he's given us the greatest book and guidance of all time called the Holy Quran in order to take away the pressure of this life. And all we have to do is worship him.
MashaAllah. That's less than 30 seconds. MashaAllah, very good. And then obviously we do dua for them, so Allah can give them hidayah, the guidance. And we keep in touch with the person. We depart with a smile perhaps, right? So they can inshallah have that perception that Muslims are good, helpful.
Yeah, don't make this mistake. Don't say, here's my number. Say, are you comfortable giving me your number and I'll just send you a text and we can be in touch? Because otherwise, you know, if you go away, wait, and then the day they haven't contacted you, you're like, I knew I should have. So I've done that before. Always make sure that you take the other person's number and you do send them something, you know, really happy asking how they're doing and wishing them well.
MashaAllah. Sister Lauren, Jazakallah khairan. And we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for guiding you, for keep on guiding us, and for giving you the ability, because there are billions of people. Allah has chosen you and has exalted you and gave you the ability to enlighten other people. So may Allah keep on rewarding you and all the Muslims and helping humanity as brothers and sisters, us coming together, worshipping the Creator, and by His mercy, inshallah, going to paradise. So again, Jazakallah khairan. May Allah reward you, sister. Assalamu alaikum.
Thank you so much. Doctor, I just want to say thank you, and you're doing great work. May Allah ta'ala increase you, bless your family, bring more people to closeness to Allah Ta'ala through your great, great work, and really give you increase. Ameen Ya Rabbal Ameen. Thank you so much.
Ameen. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. May Allah's peace and guidance and mercy be upon you. Ameen.
Ameen.